The opposition won't be opposing this bill. We will be potentially looking at amendments in the other place, in line with some of the concerns that have been raised by reputable legal organisations, because I do think that there is unanimous views that our sexual offences laws can be better, should be better.
This bill adopts an affirmative consent model, which will mean a person must confirm they've received consent, shifting scrutiny from the actions of the victim survivor to those of the accused. Consent must be communicated, it cannot be assumed. This bill also amends laws to make it explicit that stealthing, that is removing a condom without the other person's consent, is also a crime.
I'd also like to refer to the image-based offences. This is being used as a tool to circulate porn or images. It might be the deep fake porn of putting somebody's head on other existing pornographic images or videos. But it is circulated with usually the one intention of humiliating, demoralising and making a woman feel like they have less power in a relationship, whether that relationship actually exists or not, in an intimate sense.
Only one in 23 rape cases that are reported result in a conviction. This bill draws a very clear line in the sand, strengthening our sexual assault laws, providing additional protections for victim survivors, and ensuring that we are holding perpetrators to account for their actions. This bill shifts the scrutiny from victim survivors onto the perpetrators.
Today is a watershed moment in Victoria. Today, this Parliament is seeing legislation that will set a new community standard, and a new community standard that will change cultural norms in the way we can act to stop and prevent sexual violence. Not just the things that we can do to assist with reporting, but change cultural standards in a meaningful way, at law, and that's what counts.
It's so important that this bill recognises the experience of victim survivors, making it clear that there can be no consent in circumstances of family violence where a person submits to a sexual act due to force, harm, or the fear of force or harm of any kind.
It's been campaigned around no means no, and what Chanel Contos quite rightly said, it's about, yes, it's about giving permission. It's not having somebody feeling that there is peer group pressure or what's going to happen or in a vulnerable, difficult situation at the time and then living a life of fear, uncertainty, regret.
We cannot talk about this bill without talking about the context within which it arises. 87% of victims of sexual violence experience that violence from someone known to them. 46% of women who experience sexual assault do so from an intimate partner. This is rarely an issue perpetrated by a stranger lurking in the shadows. It is so often perpetrated by people we know, our friends, our colleagues, indeed sometimes even our family, people we trust.
The reforms in this bill are the first stage in the government's response to the VLRC report, and that they have recognised that there is much more to do to address sexual violence and empower victim survivors. So we look forward to seeing further consultation with victim survivor advocates, and key stakeholders to ensure there is a full response. Because in many ways, changing the law is easy compared to the broader work that needs to be done.
This government's law reform agenda has put nuance, sensitivity and the reality of sexual violence front and centre, and it shows in this bill.
They are saying enough. They are saying give us the tools, give us the power to hold people accountable who are perpetrators of sexual violence against us. And this is what this government is doing. We are absolutely putting in place the tools that help us to hold these people to account. And if you don't like it, if you don't agree with the law, don't do it.